And it's now my pleasure to introduce our expert speakers today. We're very lucky to be joined by Heather Ross McManus, Olympian, True Sport Champion, Master Coach, Developer, and CEO of Sports Minded Consulting. And we also have André Lachance, Sport Development Director for the Canadian Women's Baseball Team. He's also a university professor at the University of Ottawa and a sport management professional. And our guest coach is Thorsten Gohl, coach of NWT Table Tennis, also on the board of directors for Table Tennis Canada. Thor is also the unofficial ambassador of the North and the physical literacy coordinator with Northwest Territories. And we're all super excited for what's in store today. So without any more delay, I'd like to turn things over to Heather and André. The screen is yours. Thank you.
Thank you for this great introduction. I'm going to share my screen right away and we'll get going. So I'm quite excited, to be honest. I'll tell you a little story. So a couple of years ago, I was asked to talk at the Sport Leadership Conference, and I believe it was in Ottawa, about multi-sport. And one thing I said to the group there, I said, this is the last time you're going to hear me talk about multi-sport in the way we were talking about this. And I'm super excited because I'm hearing Spider and Thorsten, and when I hear that physical literacy, multi-sports is now part of their title, that tells us a lot about the journey that we've started some years ago, and now it's now part of those people title, which is fantastic. But what's exciting about the topic today is the fact that we're going to talk not only about multi-sport, which is important, but we're talking about how we can coach the multi-sport athletes, which is why I accepted to come and talk to you people today about this important topic. And I'm super excited, obviously, to work with Heather. We've had the opportunity to share the screen, not the stage anymore. We should share the screen several times over the last couple of years, talking about competition review, restructuring, and helping other organizations building their sport model around those concepts. So we're going to look at this here as a four different dimensions, four different lenses. So the first one will be athlete, the second one will be coach, and then we're going to talk about multi-sport through the eyes, the lens of a parent, and also an administrator. So let's get going. So the first one here is when we talk to kids, and this is backed by research. If you're interested, the U.S. have done tons of research about what it means for athletes to be, young athletes to be involved in sport. And some of the quotes that are emerging from those research. First one is, you know what, I'm 8 years old. I don't want a scholarship. I'm only 10 or 8. All I want is to play different sports. So they want to be involved. They want to be active. They want to be involved in soccer and fencing and swimming or whatever the sport that are being offered in your area. The second thing that is interesting is they say, can I finish what I've started? And the reason why they say that is that sometimes they're stuck in between two things. So they want to finish their baseball, their soccer season, but then they're going to be faced with the fact that hockey is starting. So they cannot finish baseball or soccer because hockey or basketball is starting, and they're kind of stuck in between. And they don't like that. The third thing is dad or mom, what I learned last summer in baseball is also helping me in basketball. Hello, that's something new, okay? And that's coming from kids also. So transferable skills. So I'm learning something in a sport, and like, good thing, you can apply those learnings in another physical activity, another sport. I don't want to give up anything. I'm having fun. I don't want to miss out on school sports either. So when you look at different sports system, the different scheduling issues that we could have in our country right now, that could be an issue also for athletes. So that's kind of the perspective of an athlete when it comes to multi-sport, when it comes also to simply playing sport growing up. I'll turn it over to Heather for the next one.
Okay, yeah. So from the four different perspectives, moving on to the parent, and obviously multi-sport is not always the easiest thing for a parent to maintain. So some of the comments can be like, with two jobs, two other kids, all involved in sport, I need a clear schedule. Like, how am I actually going to do all of this? And if any of you are parents as well, I'm sure that's been some, you know, many of you might have had that experience as well. I want to know if my child is having fun. So it's not just about the function of sport and the, you know, what the research says, but are they happy? Are they having fun? And then on the other hand is the success in the future. If I want my child to be the next great one, the next, you know, upcoming athlete, I need to invest where I, you know, in the best way, early in the process. They don't want to miss out. And then finally being labeled as a problem or not committed if you are supporting your child to do multi-sport. So that kind of pressure to be more committed, whether it's by other parents, by some of the people in these other roles that we're going to talk about, by whether it's coaches or other athletes, how can you find that balance between doing what's best for your child and at the same time being committed to the sport in a way that supports the team and so on?
So you'll see as we move towards the other roles that communication and clear messaging is so important when it comes to multi-sport, and Heather has alluded to some of them. So when we look at the coach, so some of the things we hear. So if Peter misses practice because of his soccer game, he won't play next game. And most of the time, Peter misses practice because he's playing another sport. Therefore, he's being penalized for being a multi-sport athlete because of coach's perception of the role of winning in a specific environment. I need Rebecca to focus on fencing more so she can win provincials. So at what age should we, and we'll talk about it later on. So what would be the perfect age for a kid in a specific sport to start specialization? And that's the question we're being asked all the time. Is it 14? Is it 12? Is it 21? Is it 21? Is it 18? So what's the perfect age to start thinking or to start specializing in one sport? I'm worried Hunter has missed too many basics and then they'll get discouraged. So obviously if you miss some practice because you're a multi-sport athlete, you might have missed some of the fundamentals of the sport. But research is showing us also that those kids will catch up quicker because they were engaged in multi-sport. So it's a paradigm shift for a coach in order to understand the benefits of playing multiple sports. And we'll give you examples later on how other organizations have embraced multi-sport and they've started to understand the benefits of them. I know you want to go to tryout for the next sport, but we still need you at practice to get ready for playoffs. Same conflicting message that we had also from the athlete perspective is they want to finish what they've started. And it's so difficult for coaches to understand that because the way the sport is structured in our country is all about competition, is all about winning Friday night, the game against the neighbor community. So that's a paradigm shift that we need to embrace and to establish in everything that we're doing.
And finally, the perspective of the administrator. And I think that last one that André mentioned, you know, coming from different people's perspectives that are involved in figuring things out, all four of these need to work together in order to make multi-sport possible for athletes. So the administrator obviously is one of those four that has to be part of that communication strategy and planning. So from the administrator's perspective, it can be challenging. So that concern that if an athlete doesn't come to every practice, they might miss progression and maybe it's not safe. So from an administrative standpoint, you know, are we meeting our standards? Are we doing sport safely? Are we planning in the proper way for those athletes? What the concern of just getting the numbers in a sport. So what if she prefers basketball over softball? And then we might not have a team or we might not have the numbers that we need to run our sport. So there's a bit of sort of competition and business side of sport that has a factor there, especially on the admin side. And then even that kind of concept of, with that in mind, let's start a year-round academy so that we do keep those people. Once they're hooked, let's keep them hooked and let's keep them involved and don't let them find out there might be other options out there because we want them in our sport to keep the numbers up. or even planning, let's schedule a playoff at the start of the next sports season so we can create conflicts. So, I mean, those are sort of the negative side of that. I think on the other side of the administrative is just how do you make a sport work? Your responsibility as an administrator is to make it functional, to make it work, to make it cost effective for the people involved. So, even with the best intentions, there are the same sort of concerns. Okay, so yeah, so the, you know, who is right and who is wrong is kind of that previous slide there, but what does it actually take to, to make multi-sport possible, and what are the benefits? So really just avoiding things like burnout, injury, inactivity in the long term for athletes or for participants are benefits that have been shown in the research of multi-sport participation, and then building that solid foundation that allows individuals to excel in whatever sport they end up maybe choosing in the long term, motivates them and allows them to have a variety of sports so that they do stay active for life and they have lots of options wherever they might be in the world or wherever they might be in their lives that they can join in and play and be active participants at whatever level of excellence they choose.
So you will see that at the bottom of most of our slides, we have a link, not a link, but a URL, playmoresports.ca. So if you're ever curious about learning more about all the data we're giving you about burnout, especially this slide here, burnout, injury, inactivity, we don't want to go through it because it's something that we've talked about before. But at the same time, if you're curious in knowing more about those data stats, it's there at playmoresports.ca, which is an initiative that was kind of unique that started some years ago, a partnership between the Canadian Olympic Committee, Active for Life, Baseball Canada, Hockey Canada, Soccer Canada, and Canada Basketball. So that was the first time ever that those four big sports start to talk together and talk among each other, saying, how can we do things differently? In order to be more efficient with athlete development. So if you're curious about it, we have some videos and all kinds of great resources there as well. So the new normal, this is where we're going. We'd like to get multi-sport as being the new normal because research shows that kids who play multiple sports have fewer injuries and continue to play longer and at a higher level than children who specialize in a sport before puberty. So it says a lot about the health of a nation and about the values of the Canadian society that, yes, if we can get athletes like Heather that will reach high standards of performance, go to the Olympics, which is fantastic, we could still have it through a multi-sport approach, but indirectly we'll have more durable human beings that will be active for life for a longer time, and therefore better for society. So it's not only about basketball, ringette, fencing, or swimming, it's about us collectively doing things better. Here's some important, like I was saying about paradigm shift. This is Ohio State football. If you think about football in the States, if you think about big programs in the States, Ohio State most of the time comes to mind. Big school where football is a religion. It's huge, okay? And if you look at those stats here, it tells you that now they are recruiting multi-sports athletes. And look at the low number of football-only athletes in high school that they've selected recently to be part of their program. It tells you that there's a change in how they do things. So they're looking for multi-sports athletes because they see value and they've seen results also as far as performance. So it tells you a lot about the shift that is happening, not only here in Canada, but around the world also. This is a U.S. example. And if, let's say, you prefer soccer, you know how soccer is a big thing in Europe, right? If you go to Germany, you go to France, you go to Spain or Italy, Portugal, this is the sport, right? So soccer is a big thing. And what happened some years ago, probably 10, 15, 20 years ago, we saw emergence of academies. So whether it's the Barca, whether it's the French program, all started their own club academy. So what they've started to do is that they start to recruit really, really, really young at the age of 8, 9, 10, so they could stay with them and they could stay within the organization for years. But look what happened. So this is one, like we talk about Ohio State's football in the USA. Now we're talking about probably the biggest soccer club and team, professional team in Europe, which is in Germany, in Munich. So I think they, again, won the Champions Cup, whatever they call it. I'm not a soccer expert, but they're performing year after year. But what it tells you here, they used to target kids that young, but they realized that it was not worth it. So they just recently decided that they will not offer programs anymore for those kids at that age group. Because they, if you read the article, it says, we now realize that there is a value in multi-sport, there's value in them playing other sports, and then we can have them later on, and they're going to be better. So it's a totally different approach. And they realize it, obviously, at the beginning, they want to go about specialization because that's the way to go. But with research, new data, they realize the opposite. So two examples of big organizations. And if they can do it, I'm assuming that Ottawa can do it, Yellowknife can do it, Whitehorse can do it, and other any cities in Canada can do this. If those programs can do it, anyone can do it for sure.
As far as going back to that parent perspective and what do parents have to pay attention to in terms of supporting multi-sport and making it possible, one thing is that it's been shown that the quiet majority actually support, of parents actually support multi-sport and believe in multi-sport, rather than the vocal minority of those who you hear, my kid needs more this, we need to do more of, you know, more tournaments, more this, more that, you know, more dedication. And so it's really the quiet majority, that it is a majority. It's, and to remember that from the parent perspective, that the ones that are the loudest are not necessarily the biggest in numbers as well. So yes, the quiet majority of parents do support multi-sport. And so whatever role you may be in, keeping that in mind can really help, I think, in terms of moving forward and having the confidence to continue supporting multi-sport.
And if I can add to this, parents operates with what I like to say, sound bites. They will watch things on TV and they will act according to what they see. Even though they don't clearly understand the message, they will adopt it. Clear example is Tiger Woods. If you remember little Tiger, when he, I think he was 4 or 5, he went on TV and he got like recognition as being the next big one and so on and so forth. And then he went all the way through the process of being a good athlete at university and became a professional, made lots of money, but ran into lots of troubles too, physically, socially, tons of issues. But at the time, people thought that, okay, that's the route I have to take if I want to become the next one, as Heather alluded before, versus the quiet Roger Federer, who never really mentioned, we never heard about his journey in sport, but he was a multi-sport athlete. Is he durable? I think he is, like his late 30s, and he's still performing. I'll give you another example. Another example is, and the question, I can ask you the question. At what age do you think the Williams sisters in tennis started to do competition? And people think, oh, it might be 10 or 12 years old. Well, they haven't started before the age of 15, 16. And are they durable today? Well, they're pretty good. Like even Venus at 40 is pretty good tennis player at her age, especially in that sport where peak of performance is a bit earlier. So just to say that people operate with those type of messages, and we have a role to play also, especially administrators, as far as what type of messages we want to put out there to promote multi-sport. So parents also ask about fun. And Heather mentioned it earlier, like, okay, is my kid having fun in the sport? And how do we measure that? What makes the difference? Do we have any different types of fun? Here's what I played with that recently, but tried to simplify something that I found that was really, really complicated. But here's how I can explain it. We'll start from the center, because we'll talk about the experience of the participant. So when you start in any program at the entry level, whether you're swimming or gymnastics, whatever it is, you're discovering the discipline, you're discovering the sport. It's an easy fun, right? So you're there with your friends and it's an easy fun, you're just exploring. Then you get a little bit more curious, getting all the way here to the curve at the top of my diagram. And then in most sports, especially in team sports, you get to what we call like age group divisions, right? So you're U9, U11 and everything. And then you get to a little bit more what we call a more serious fun, where you get excited about what's going to come next and competition and everything. It's a bit more serious. And then you get to the hard fun, which is a little bit more commitment. And this is where high performance programs are coming into place. And then on the technical, physical, tactical, and mental, this is more towards the mastery of your craft as an athlete, right? And the hard fun was probably Heather's thing when she was an Olympian, right? Like, it's fun, but it's hard.
I just think right away to that feeling of like getting in the zone, or feeling like you have that moment of absolute, like, nailing what you tried to do, and that feeling, and that to me is that mastery or hard fun, when all that hard work comes together to make, and it feels perfect or easy in a way, but it's been
hard. Yeah, exactly. And then throughout the course of your journey, you could go to any active life program. That's how it's all about your health as a person. And it's about people fun. So meaning that the social aspect is coming back to you. You play in a garage league in hockey. You play volleyball for fun. You play at night, play with badminton or squash with your social, with your friends. You're being active. It's about your health, but it's also about people fun, where the social becomes a bit important. So that's kind of important for parents to understand also, is what type of fun my kid is in, and what type of environment can produce or help my child to develop throughout the course of this.
And I would even go one step further to say that most people need some of each in their lives. So one thing that multi-sport can provide is, one sport might be your easy fun, you're learning something new, and you might be at a mastery stage in another sport, and both are fun in very different ways. But having different sports that provide different, you know, some, maybe another sport is just where you go to play with your friends, you know, school sport might be like that for some athletes that are actually high performance athletes in another sport, but they don't want to miss out on their school volleyball tournament day or that kind of thing.
Very good point. Thanks for saying it. So if we go back to coaches, and what do coaches have to pay attention to? So there's two elements, and you saw that I put in big letters here, recovery and regeneration versus performance and winning. It's on purpose. So it means that the attention of the coaches, especially dealing with the multi-sports athlete, should be highly looking at the recovery of the athlete and regeneration. If you remember the polling at the start, we gave you three options. And if you remember the three options, none of them were talking about recovery and regeneration. That's why we asked the question, because we think this is an important aspect of coaching. And this is funny, and this is why I put this slide there. If you get to your phone and you see this, you got 20% left, or maybe 5% left, and you got those two options. You go to low power mode or you close it. You never allow your phone to die. You put it to charge, right? And the same thing, if I'm talking over the phone with Heather and it says I have 5% or 2% left, I'm gonna say, Heather, we gotta stop it because I'm gonna lose you here, okay? I'm not gonna say, I'm gonna continue. I'll talk to myself even though the phone is dying, right? So it's funny that we don't allow our phone to do this, but when it's time for our athletes to go through sports and dealing with recovery, we do allow it to happen. So let's put it in the perspective of an athlete. if the athlete has low battery. So you could go to low power mode, which means like, okay, let's decrease volume, intensity, frequency of practice and those type of things. Or we shut that athlete down totally. You go to rest and you do no basketball or no ring up for a week or 2 weeks, whatever the reasons are. So that tells us something is in between sports. Like if you play a sport every season, you play two or three sports during the course of the year, going back to the polling questions, or you play soccer 12 months a year, you need to allow for proper recovery and regeneration. If you don't do it, if you don't talk to the previous sport coach about what type of environment the athlete was in, what type of intensity, then we're going to end up with athletes that are going to be burned out. And that's back to what Heather mentioned earlier. So that's a good analogy that I found to explain to you the importance of recovery. And quickly, I don't want it to be a university course, but I quickly want to explain how it works. So if you follow my mouse here, we are going to use the green line. So the green line is right now. Okay, we go for a workout, we go for a run. Let's use that. We go for a run, we go for a 10K run. And obviously as we run, once we're going to be done, our level of performance will go down because fatigue will be there, right? So we're going to be more fatigued. Therefore, my level of performance is lower than it was before starting. When you allow for proper recovery, I'm going back up and the body will super compensate, knowing that the system will become better than it was before. Okay, so if we keep doing this, your performance that was here at the beginning, that is now here, and if I apply another load here, it's going to go down and back. So my progression will go up and will move up all the time. If I do apply, let's use again the green one. If I do apply another load or another practice at the wrong time and not allow fatigue to finish and not allow recovery to happen, that line of progression will go down. And this is not what we want. We want result. We want to have something better at the end of the day. So we need to manage it properly in order to have a good result. So I don't want it to be too complicated, but I just want to have a feel about how it works for in the human body. Was that still me, Heather?
I can say something about this one. Yeah. I can't quite remember. I lost track. So as far as administrators, and we, you know, part of what we mentioned earlier was, you know, administrators having that responsibility to make sport work, to make it cost effective, to make the logistics work, and that idea of working together, and maybe that's working together with the other roles that we talked about, or working together with other sports, the way that the Play More Sports initiative, you know, talked different sports on how can we do this together, how can we work together to make multi-sport possible and to support athletes, participants in being able to do what they want to do. Whereas alone, trying to figure it out alone as a single sport without communicating, without planning, is really not going to work. And unfortunately, I think when multi-sport first started getting attention, it was like, yeah, the athletes maybe bought in, or the parents maybe bought in, or one club might buy in, but it doesn't actually work very well until you have all of the players, all of the stakeholders working together, communicating, and trying to solve those challenges together. So one of the things that we especially thought about for this, because I think we get buy-in in terms of multi-sport when you're talking about young kids, you know, like when you're talking about learn to train, or that stage where young people are sampling sports, trying new things. It's not hard to talk people into why multi-sport is valuable. Maybe they don't know yet what sport they're going to really love. Maybe they don't know, you know, where their skills will develop. Developing a broad range of skills is a good foundation. All those things are sort of obvious when you look at the earlier stages. Where it becomes more complicated is as you move further through the stages of development. And I think this is where we tend to get sort of maybe pushback from either administrators, coaches, or even parents who want their child to be the next, you know, the next great one, or even athletes who are afraid of missing out or afraid they're not doing enough because they have big dreams. So thinking about when and why to specialize in a sport, there's a lot of reasons. And so I had some that I've heard and some that I, you know, I've heard from coaches, parents, kids, some that have gone through my own head, and I just put some of them here. So sort of an artificial reason that I hear a lot, and especially in acrobatic sport where my background is, what if he gets hurt doing something else? I've heard it in hockey, and I've heard it, you know, we don't want them to get hurt because they have a tournament this weekend. And you hear that at every age group all the way through. And I think, well, we don't want to get any athlete to get hurt regardless. But that's sort of an artificial reason to specialize in sport. However, the realistic side of that type of thinking is two simultaneous sports are actually leading to a greater likelihood of injury. So an athlete that's been doing multi-sport as a young, you know, learn to train, maybe starting to move into the train to train stage and still trying to maintain simultaneous sports where they're not getting that recovery and regeneration opportunity, or whether maybe the sports are similar to each other. At some point, trying to do too much at too high a level can actually, instead of protecting from burnout and injury, is it a possibility that it's too much? Are they overtraining? Are they doing too much? Another reason on the sort of that I've heard, parents of a young athlete are afraid they won't make the team if they don't participate in all the other training. So, you know, there's summer training for gymnastics, or summer spring hockey, or whatever the sport might be. Often sport clubs or sport organizations, for financial reasons or because they have interest, have all season round training. But being afraid that they won't get known by the coaches, that they won't get the opportunities if they aren't there all the time is a reason that you sometimes hear. On the other hand, maybe that's a realistic reason. As an athlete moves into the train to compete stage, they're past puberty now, and they've actually chosen a sport that they're absolutely passionate about. And their off-season training adds to their enjoyment, adds to their recovery, adds to their skill, and it's well planned, then that is a more reasonable reason to specialize rather than because what if I miss out on something because I do another sport. And then it's too much work for the coach to do special planning for one multi-sport player who needs special treatment. And yes, it is more work for the coach, but hopefully coaches are in it for the athletes, right? For their participants and what's best for them. So looking at whether, you know, an athlete that's trying to balance a number of things, actually helping them, hopefully part of a coach's to help them. As athletes get later and later into their sport experience, even with good communication and planning, keeping up with two sports may no longer be enjoyable or may no longer be sustainable. So at some point, if an athlete is, you know, wanting in their choice, in their motivation to be dedicated and excel in one sport, at some point it may not be sustainable to keep up another sport at that same level of commitment. And so another reason, you know, you hear maybe coaches say every athlete on the team must be dedicated 100%, full attendance, no exceptions for anything. And then we saw the one about, you know, they get benched if they miss a practice, or they can't sit out for the game, no matter what the reason. Ideally, that extreme is not really necessary. Like if there's a good reason, maybe a coach can build into it. You know, you can miss up to this many, or these ones are not as important as these ones in terms of what commitment is required for different aspects of the sport. On the other hand, maybe an athlete is excited to give 100% to her primary sport, and other sports are fun, but they're secondary. So just sort of knowing that, yes, I'm going to do another sport, but I'm going to, you know, commit to my team because my team has reached a level where that's required. And again, looking at sort of train to compete, maybe even moving into train to win type of stages of development. And again, because the athlete is motivated to do that, not just because it's demanded. And then, so a big part of making it possible is how to plan. As a coach, if you're in that role of coach or even administrator, how can you plan to make this possible and successful and overcome some of the barriers? So do prioritize the well-being and happiness of the athletes, right? So, you know, whether that's supporting multi-sport, whether if they're spreading themselves too thin, that you, you know, you notice it and you help them figure out how to plan better. Also require advanced planning. So yes, it is hard for a coach. So it can't be disorganized. So an athlete that wants to be a multi-sport athlete as they move into higher levels of a sport has to take some responsibility for that, for good communication, for communicating when they're tired, for advanced planning if there are conflicting commitments from different sports. Do also be clear about what is non-negotiable. So what came up earlier was safety. Like if you miss certain fundamentals of a sport, it could be unsafe if you don't know the rules or if you don't know the drill and you're in the wrong place, or if you've missed a foundational movement in an acrobatic sport or a risky sport. There are certain things that in sport participation are non-negotiable. Can you find a way to make sure the athlete gets those and also is able to participate in other sports as well? Communicating with the athletes about their goals, and this, regardless of whether it's multi-sport or not, is always valuable because it's often amazing to realize that some athletes are there for the social reasons. They're there for the social fun, even if they're playing at a high level. Other athletes are there because they have a dream of the Olympics, and you might not have even known it if you just looked at, you know, what they were doing any given day. So asking athletes about their goals and priorities and helping them then to make those plans ahead accordingly. And rather than do's and don'ts, I had, other things also to do. Communicate with the athlete, communicate with their parents and their other coaches so that when appropriate, if the sports are overlapping or if they're doing fitness training in one sport and fitness training in the other sport and you're feeling like they're getting too tired, to plan for balancing those multiple sports and making sure there actually is recovery time. Ensuring that athletes and parents are also taking that responsibility and are educated enough about rest and recovery and what's required, and they're not just filling every off day that you think they're resting with their other sport, and so they may not be getting rest if that's the case. So watching for warning signs, watching for burnout and overuse injuries. And then checking in regularly with athletes on your team, like checking in about when does soccer start or when does your next sport, or if it may be a secondary sport, but still showing interest and checking in with them on how those things are going and whether their goals are still the same as when you talked to them before. And overall, I think the biggest message in my mind, and whether it's high performance or grassroots sport or long-term participation, sport should be contributing to the participants' lives in a positive way.
And if I can add this, funny enough, when you ask coaches, what would you do if you were guaranteed you would not lose any game throughout the course of the season? And most of the time, they will answer all those beautiful things. So it tells us a lot about how the competition system impacts coaches' decision when it comes to athlete development. So that those are great do's and addition to what we should be doing. So can we imagine a new normal in Canada with regards to multi-sport? Knowing that sport is organized around the concept that kids who practice many different sports before puberty are set for success later. So that could be a great principle. The second one is sports don't compete against each other to attract kids, but work together to allow kids to participate in more than one sport. That'd be awesome. Sports collaborate and offer integrated multi-sports programs to young kids. Can you imagine if we could work together and the services or the offering to the parents and the kids were multi-sports, especially in fundamental learn to train stage of development? This leads to more elite athletes because kids are motivated to play in sports instead of dropping out because they're burned out or going through injuries. And we see that a lot, especially after the high school years, where the drop is pretty important. And more people remain engaged in sport and obviously more durable and more active for life. So that's a campaign we had, I believe it was 2 years ago. It was called Change It Up. Playing more sport is better. So the website is there. It's a micro site that share scientifically sound bites for parents and coaches. There is a video there, a PSA that we produce as well. And that concludes and the presentation we had for you guys today.
Thank you, Heather, and merci, André. That was a great presentation, and I fully believe in the message that you're giving. And hopefully at some point in the future that we can do that, some kind of similar website and some kind of with similar approach in the Northwest Territories, because I think we have seen that already in so many ways. Before we start, I want to say we respect and acknowledge the First Nations, Indigenous Inuit, and Métis people of Canada as the keepers of the territories up on which we host this webinar today. And in Fort Providence, that would be the Dega Gautier First Nation. For me, from a table tennis perspective, is we are looking at so many activities and opportunities that we have in the North. And some of them come through the school sport, where we have soccer, basketball, volleyball, tennis, badminton, table tennis, and many, many more. Cross-country run that we do here in Fort Providence. And all these opportunities that come for the kids to get active and participate, not just to do the activities in the sport, but actually to go into the communities to travel. And that comes with big multi-sport games as well, like the North American Indigenous Games, the Active Winter Games, the Canada Games, and the Western Canada Games. And that doesn't even include the provincial or national events that are happening as well. So there's a lot of opportunity for the kids not just to engage in sport, but also engage in traveling, meeting others, having fun activities. And so that's one of the main focus for us here in the North and for table tennis is grassroots, just to get as many people active, have fun, enjoy the game. And if it's just table tennis, that's perfect. We follow the physical literacy principle is motivate confidence, physical competency, knowledge and understanding, and then hopefully being active for life. That's the main purpose for us. And no matter if you call it table tennis or ping pong, if you play the game and you're active with it, we are happy. So one of the highlights is our school tournament every year. And here you see some pictures of kids just participating in the game. And if you know the kids or you don't know the kids, none of them are active table tennis kids. So all of these kids are participating in sport because their school participates and they want to have fun. They want to engage. And we have a lot of smiles. We have 150 kids every single year. And for me, the most exciting part is that we have the table set up and the kids are just standing around and cheering on, and something that is not normally happening within in the national organization or on a competition way that the kids can stay that close to the table. But here they're cheering, they're high-fiving in the middle of the game, and it's just a pleasure to watch. I give an example from the Canada Games, and that was the Canada Games in Red Deer. So when we look at our team picture, we see on the left-hand side, that's Shannon, and Shannon is a table tennis athlete. Next to that is Coach Jody. Jody is a figure skating coach. Then we have Monica right next to her. Monica plays tennis. Then Gracie, who is Jody's daughter, we have, and she does volleyball and futsal and soccer. Connor right next to that, he plays hockey. Then we have Nikki, who sports are futsal and tennis and table tennis. Then we have David, and his sport is gymnastics. We have our mission step at that point was Jack, and Jack does soccer. And then me, of course, we do table tennis. So again, we see a whole variety where this is a table tennis team, but really we have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 other sports, and I'm sure that all these kids participate in all other sports as well. So it's fantastic to watch that. How we prepared for the Canada Games, and that's how we're going to do it for all other sports, for all our games from now on, is we engage the kids in different fun activities. Here we said we're going to do soccer just to as a warm-up. and do drills, not just play soccer, but actually do the drills, do the workout, and learn more new skills. So it was fun activities. Of course, we play table tennis, tennis. So we're playing tennis, but with table tennis balls and rackets, and just engaging as much as possible and trying to include everybody. So here you see 3 against 3, and it's much harder than it looks like. We're doing fun activities where we take the kids out and do some team activities, play bowling. The next one is we're going to visit the home hardware store in Hay River. And what happened is this is where one of our athletes works. So we just said, oh, we're going to go inside and play some table tennis in there just to show our support. In previous games, we did as well go to concerts of some of our kids that had musical interests and participated in there to build those strong binds between the kids. This is Kichi Squad, the Spirit Squad, sorry, with Kichi in the back, and this is the mascot of the 2018 Active Winter Games hosted in Fort Smith and Hay River. And we said, okay, let's do a session with those kids. We teach them table tennis while they teach us some dance skills. Coming together and just enjoying it, and it was fun. Parents engagement, trying to get the parents engaged, cheering them on while they cheer us on. And it was a huge hit, especially in Red Deer, where we used the term of saying when I or Jack screamed N, everybody saying T. So N, T, N, T, N, T, N, T, and so that's how the entire time. And now I still hear every time I go to a national championship, someone's really screaming N, and I'm like, what's this? And oh yeah, T. So it's still happening all around, and our kids are excited about it. Making friendships. This is Fuang from Manitoba, just posing for a picture, getting them engaged, getting to know other kids, and creating those relationships as well. Giving gifts, I mean, that's a good one. I think for the first time ever that we gave every single opponent that we played against a gift, and we were part of that preparation for those gifts. And it was fun to see those smiles, and of course, those faces like, what's this? Why? And but it was great. Creating memories. So we printed each picture for each child as well, and then said, write a note on the back and then share that with your teammates. So just beautiful. And then after the games, we engaged the kids and said, we're hosting events outside. And this is the Snow Castle in Yelena. Invite the kids to come in and then participate and play with other kids. I think that is it for my presentation from the picture perspective. And the most important thing what we're trying to do is we're going to try and give the tools and experience to our athletes to become the best person that they can be, as you can read here. Having fun, being a role model, and the future leaders in our communities while being active for life. So I think we're lucky in the North that we have those opportunities with the multi-sport games and the school tournaments every year. And it's a blast. I mean, everybody enjoys it. So thank you very much, everyone.
Wow. It's very cool to see accomplished NWT folks like Thor, living the words, living the magic that multi-sport brings. We'd like to enthusiastically and wholeheartedly thank our experts today, Heather and André and Thor, for stepping up and sharing with us what was certainly very engaging for me. And we look forward to upcoming webinars. We'll keep you abreast of those as they come up. Thank you very much, presenters, and Kim from CERC, and everyone for finding time and coming out today. Thank you so much.